Welcome back, everybody. And Dr. Rani Gupta is also joined. Let me introduce the concept of Journal Club India chapter. This activity is definitely there to initiate the research reading among postgraduate students as well as the researchers, because there are various articles which needs to be decoded in terms of IMRAD format or various research technicalities. So Council for Ayurveda Research has started this activity in US for a longer duration, and since December, we have started an India chapter, and we have successfully conducted two meetings, and this is our third meeting with Dr. Abhishek Lulla. Let me introduce our co-chair for Journal Club India chapter, Dr. Rani Gupta, and she is a gold medalist from BHU in gynecology post-graduation. She is working as a medical director and Ayurvedic gynecologist at SKK Ayurveda, New Delhi, since 2006. She has a vast experience of 18 years in various clinical aspects of infertility management, Garbha Sanskar, and also PCOD. And she has specialized Panchakarma trainings along with Uttar Basti with encouraging results. She is into training for short-term Ayurveda courses for international and national students. And she's also associated with many NGOs for social welfare programs for women health issues. And I would like to invite Dr. Rani Gupta to take on the next session and introduce Dr. Abhishek Lulla, today's presenter for Journal Club meeting. Dr. Rani Gupta, please.
Thank you so much, Dr. Pranita. Namaskar to all the participants. So on this auspicious day of Vasant Panchami, may Goddess Saraswati bless us all with all knowledge, health, and wisdom. So it's a great pleasure to introduce our speaker, Dr. Abhishek A. Lulla, who is going to talk about a case study paper with title Effects of Turmeric on Alzheimer's Disease with behavioral and psychological symptoms of dementia. Dr. Abhishek A. Lulla is MD in Kaya Chikitsa and consultant physician at the reputed Arya Vaidya Pharmacy, Chennai. He is the founder of Ayurvedic Wellness Center, Chennai. Dr. Abhishek is also one of the founding directors of Ayurvidya Abhiyan Anusandhan Foundation, which is the India chapter of Council of Ayurveda Research, USA. He is currently a part of many research projects, has authored several papers, and has taken part in many international and national conferences. He was a former assistant professor in the Department of Panchakarma at Sri Jayendra Saraswati Ayurveda College, Chennai, and was also the research and medical consultant for Nanolife Specialty Medical Center, where he did research on green nanotechnology and cancer. His area of specializations include management of chronic pains and lifestyle disorders. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Abhishek on this auspicious day. Thank you so much, Dr. Abhishek.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for the kind introduction. And thank you, Pranita, ma'am, for having me here today. So I would just start the screen share. Give me a second. I hope it's visible to everyone.
Yes.
So as the founding director of Ayurvedya Anusandhan Abhiyan Foundation, I was invited here to be a part of this wonderful initiative, which is the Journal Club meeting. And I had to choose a topic which was, you know, which could reach a wider audience. So what I decided to do, okay, so before we begin, a small little disclaimer that this presentation is only for academic purposes and it by no means intends to harm or criticize the investigator or any other person connected to the manuscript. And so when I had to choose a topic, you know, a lot of people were asking me that, you know, is Ayurveda, you know, really practiced outside of India? And if it is, in which countries? So I tried to find a research publication which was outside of India. And this publication was done in Ayu Journal, which was done in the September of 2016. It was done by a wonderful team in Aichi, Japan, which was done under the Nippon Ayurveda School and the Korea Toyota General Hospital. So I chose this topic because I just wanted to know that, yes, a lot of people outside of India are also trying Ayurveda. But the problem with them is they're not getting a lot of our combinations, our rasa aushadhis. So they do a lot of research on single drugs and on rasayana drugs. So here I've taken one very simple common rasayana aushadhi, and which is turmeric, which is there in everyone's household. And this is a wonderful article which shows the effects of turmeric on Alzheimer's disease with behavior and psychological symptoms of dementia. As you all know, Alzheimer's disease has no cure in the Western medicine. And even in Ayurveda, a lot of people are trying to find a cure. So here this team has taken 3 cases and treated them with turmeric. So the abstract here, one second. So we describe here 3 patients with Alzheimer's disease whose behavioral symptoms were improved remarkably as a result of turmeric treatment, which is the traditional Indian medicine. Their cognitive decline and behavioral and psychological symptoms of dementia, which will be referred to as PPSD, were very severe. All the 3 patients exhibited irritability, agitation, anxiety, and apathy. 2 patients also suffered from urinary incontinence. They were prescribed turmeric powder capsules and started recovering from the symptoms without any adverse reaction in the clinical symptom and laboratory data. After 12 weeks of treatment, the total score of the neuropsychiatric inventory brief questionnaire decreased significantly in both acuity of symptoms and burden of caregivers. In one case, the mini mental state examination score was up 5 points from 12 on 30 to 17 on 30. In the other 2 cases, no significant change was seen in the MMSE. However, they came to recognize their family within 1 year of treatment. All cases have been taking turmeric for more than a year, and re-exacerbation of BPSD was not seen. The present case suggests a significant improvement of the behavioral symptoms in Alzheimer's disease with turmeric treatment, leading to probable benefits of the use of turmeric in individuals with Alzheimer's disease with BPSD. So coming to introduction here, Alzheimer's is the most common form of dementia and is characterized by progressive cognitive impairment. The behavior and psychological symptoms of dementia are also commonly seen in patients with Alzheimer's, such as hallucinations, delusions, apathy, depression, agitation, irritability, and wandering. These symptoms can have a serious harmful effects on the quality of life and are also a burden on caregivers and increase the cost of care. Therefore, treatment of PPSD is as important as the core symptom, such as memory loss, disturbance, and disorientation. Acetylcholinesterase inhibitors and N-methyl D-aspirate receptor uncompetitive antagonists are commonly used for a treatment of Alzheimer's. They are effective in core symptoms and PPSD treatment. However, the effects are not completely satisfactory. They can cause adverse effects such as nausea, extrapyramidal symptoms, drowsiness, and other symptoms. So even in my practice, I've seen that a lot of patients who are on the Western medicine for Alzheimer's still come to us because of the complication. And I've seen patients who have developed Parkinson's, who have developed other complications. So, the handling such cases becomes very difficult. So neuropathologically, Alzheimer's disease is characterized by the presence of senile plaques, then neurofibrillary tangles, persistent neuronal loss. Although the neurotoxic mechanisms have not been completely elucidated, it is clear that both oxidative stress and inflammation play a key role in the illness. So this is something which we have to pay key attention to. Inflammation is the cause of most of today's today's sufferings and today's illnesses. And here we have inflammation, which causes not only physical problems, it also causes inflammation, can also cause a lot of problems in the neurological cases. And Alzheimer's disease is what's in one such case. So recent reports have suggested the therapeutic potential of curcumin in the pathophysiology of Alzheimer's disease because of its antioxidant, anti-inflammatory, and anti-amyloid effects. Curcumin is a polyphenolic molecule extracted from turmeric, the spice consisting of the powdered rhizome of the plant Curcuma longa. A turmeric contains about 5% curcumin, which gives the spice its yellow color and is used widely as a yellow food coloring. It also has a medical history that dates back to 5,000 years. It has been extensively used to treat various ailments for centuries in Ayurveda. The traditional Indian system of medicine, such as arthritis, in gastric ulcer, jaundice, fever, liver disease, urinary tract infection, skin diseases, and as a blood purifier. So most of Ayurvedic medias here, we use turmeric mainly as a blood purifier. We use it in acne. We use Haridra Khanda in allergies. But we forget to see that basically this is anti-inflammatory and can also be used in other conditions, like, for example, cancer. And many pharmacological studies have been conducted to describe the multiple biological actions of curcumin. Curcumin also has demonstrated neuroprotective effects in animal models of not only Alzheimer's disease, however, also Parkinson's disease, depression, epilepsy, and so on. Personally, I have also used this in Parkinson's disease as a rasayana chikitsa, post-shodhana, and I've seen that there's been a good improvement. Epidemiological studies in India, a country where turmeric consumption is widespread, suggest that it is one of the lowest prevalence rates of Alzheimer's in the world. So this is a point to be noted. In India, we have one of the lowest rates of Alzheimer's. In spite of high efficacy and safety, curcumin has not yet been approved as a therapeutic agent. So here we present three cases with Alzheimer's disease whose behavioral symptoms and ability to perform activities of daily living were improved by turmeric treatment without any adverse effects. So first case here. So this patient was an 83-year-old female who developed progressive dementia. She had started to exhibit disturbances of short-term memory loss and orientation. So when she was 76 years. So she had this from about 7 years. And there was no past history of diabetes or hypertension or dyslipidemia or head injury. The medical family history was unremarkable. She also had difficulty in learning new information. So gradually her daily activity was disturbed. She had an increasing difficulty in getting dressed, in cooking, in coordination of household tasks. She wandered aimlessly around the house and had incontinence of urine. So incontinence of urine is what we see in a lot of patients who have Alzheimer's, and it sometimes becomes a big nuisance. And we have the children, the caretakers coming to us that, sir, we need help in this. She had some also psychobehavioral changes such as apathy, anxiety, agitation, and irritability. She required the presence of a caregiver, though she was prescribed ACHE inhibitors and yokukansan, which is a traditional Japanese medicine. So this basically, yokukansan is a combination of 7 herbs. It is a traditional Japanese medicine and is normally given at a dose of about 2.5 gram 3 times a day, if you give it in a powder form, or we give it in extract form, it's normally given at a dose of about 100 mg 3 times a day. So when she was about 83 years old, she scored 1 on 30 on her mini mental state examination, which was used to evaluation of the cognitive function. So the MMSE basically is a scoring mechanism where it starts on 30. So a person who is normal will be 30. Someone who has a mild Alzheimer's disease will have a score of about 20. And as the severity increases, the score will drop. So someone who has a score of a 0 or a 1 on 30 shows that they have a very severe progressive stage of Alzheimer's. So her physical examination was largely normal. There were no extra pyramidal or pyramidal signs or findings, or laboratory tests were all normal. So this is something over here, what we see that in Alzheimer's, the laboratory tests are normally all normal. The only investigation which shows any sort of changes is the MRI. And here for her, the MRI demonstrated a symmetrical bilateral temporary atrophy. Age-related atrophy also is common, so we really cannot say that this would have been the cause. So now coming to her treatment, so here a turmeric was given at 764 mg per day, or curcumin of 100 mg per day, and the treatment was given for 12 weeks, and both scores of acuity of symptoms and the burden of caregivers were in also were decreased by the Japanese version of the Neuropsychiatric Inventory Brief Questionnaire, which is called as the NPIQ. Among the NPIQ subscales, her agitation, apathy, anxiety, and irritability were relieved. She began to tell about the need to urinate, which is something very, very important. You know, and when we have a patient who can control the urine and can tell about the urge to urinate, this is a big success. Furthermore, she came to join in the laughter watching TV, TV comedy programs. She began to sing some song and do knitting, which she would used to do. After taking turmeric for more than 1 year, she came to recognize her family and seemed to remind of her late husband as she lived a peaceful life without any significant BPSD. So as you can see the chart over here, the before treatment and after treatment, look at the points over here, which she had earlier was the agitation, anxiety, and irritability all reduced. So we see that with just turmeric, there was an increase in the quality of life. Now we go on to the second case here. So this is an 84-year-old female which presented at a hospital with the purpose of taking medical advice for progressive dementia. Her symptoms were forgetfulness, disorientation to place and time, hallucination, delusion, agitation, irritability, depression, apathy, wandering, and incontinence of urine, which developed several years prior to the presentation. So as you can see, in both the cases, they have the similar type of symptoms. She, while had a history of hypertension, there was no family history of dementia, and she was a non-smoker and drank little alcohol. So it's again important to know whether there's a family history, because a lot of patients having Alzheimer's disease have a family history of dementia. So her physical examination and her laboratory data include hematograms, biochemistry, and urine analysis were all normal. At the time of her visit, her cognitive decline was very, very severe, and her MMSE score was a 0 on 30, which shows that this is, again, a very, very severe case of dementia. So on her cerebral MRI revealed that there was a moderate bilateral temporal atrophy with the mild ventricular dilation. ACHE inhibitors could not be used because of the side effects. Her BPSD, including agitation, irritability, and anxiety, was not improved, though she was prescribed Yokugansan, which is a traditional Japanese formulation, and was also given atypical antipsychotic drugs. So we began to administer turmeric at 764 mg per day, which is basically curcumin 100 mg per day to her. She gradually calmed down. Her BPSD, which were hallucination, delusion, depression, agitation, apathy, anxiety, and irritability, were relieved. She stopped urinating outside the front door. She came to put on her clothes properly and distinguish her family from staff of the care center. About 12 weeks, judging from the Japanese version of NPQI, both acuity of BPSD and burden of caregivers were revealed. She has been taking turmeric for more than a year, and she lives in a peaceful manner with her family. So this is something remarkable. A patient having a score of 0 on 30, you know, with treatment would find a good improvement. As you can see over here in the chart, the before and after, the score from 12 of the acuity of symptoms has come down to 6, and the burden of the caregivers from 8 has come down to 5. And now we have a third patient here. So this patient was a 79-year-old male patient presented at a hospital accompanied by his wife. So can you just please put it on mute if you don't mind? Yeah, I'm sorry. So a 79-year-old male patient presented at a hospital accompanied by his wife. She reported that a short-term memory loss gradually developed over several years. Though he was already prescribed ACHA inhibitors by his previous doctors for about 3 years, he wanted to stay at home and lived an idle life. He stopped hinting his oil paints, which he used to do for his hobby. He had an history of hypertension being treated with losartan potassium. The medical family history, however, was insignificant. His physical examination was normal. And normal blood test, the routine blood tests were normal, which included the thyroid function, the serum vitamin B1, B12, and folic acid. The cerebral MRI also demonstrated mild bilateral temporal atrophy with mild ischemic changes in the deep white matter. A single photon emission computed tomography showed typical Alzheimer's disease pattern, which means perfusion in the temporal, parietal, and posterior cingulate in the it was significantly decreased. So his MMSE score was a 12 on 30 with poor orientation to place and time, calculation, concentration, recall, transcription of the figure, spontaneous writing, and verbal fluency. His BPSD was agitation, depression, apathy, anxiety, euphoria, eating behavior, and irritability. Here also, turmeric at 764 mg was given for 12 weeks, and it revealed and it relieved the patient's BDS, especially the agitation, irritability, and depression. Both scores of acuity of symptoms and burden of the caregivers were decreased in the Japanese version of the NPIQ. His MMAP score was up 5 points. So from a 12 on 30, it had gone up to 17 on 30 after a treatment of 12 weeks, which improved, which shows that there was an improvement in the calculation, the concentration, the transcription of the figure, and spontaneous writing. He has been taking turmeric for more than a year, and he lives calmly with his wife. So as you know, there was an increase in his score, but also what you can see over here, the acuity of symptoms was reduced from 15 to 5 points, and the burden of caregivers was reduced from 21 points to 11, which is quite remarkable. And now if you were to see all the three cases post the treatment with turmeric for a period of 12 weeks, in all the three cases, there was a change in the total score of acuity. I'm sorry, there's some problem here, it's hanging. Just give me a minute, there's some problem here with the Wi-Fi. Yeah, so we're back again. Yeah, so now coming to the discussion part. So here we reported three cases of Alzheimer's disease whose BPSD were significantly improved by the terminal treatment evaluated by the NPIQ. The NPIQ is a brief, reliable, and a clinical rating instrument that evaluates the neuropsychiatric symptoms in dementia patients and associated caregiver distress and effects of the pharmacological treatment on these symptoms and caregiver distress. Therefore, in this study, we evaluated using the NPI, confirmed that the turmeric treatment improved the behavioral symptoms associated with Alzheimer's disease. The presence study found that turmeric was effective for the treatment of several BPSD, including delusions, hallucinations, apathy, anxiety, irritability, and depression. In all cases, the total score of the NPIQ decreased significantly in both the acuity of symptoms and burden of caregivers, which was seen in the slide before. And the clinical improvements were gradually observed within 12 weeks of turmeric administration, and the caregivers were released from the associated distress. In case one and case three, clonazepam was being administered for several years before starting the turmeric treatment, and the effect of clonazepam on BPSD may therefore already have reached a stable state. Turmeric did, however, further decrease the NPIQ score, already decreased by clonazepam. So BPSD can impair the quality of life in the patient and also the caregiver. There is a positive correlation between the severity of BPSD and the care burden. And treatment of BPSD is as important as the treatment of core symptoms. So as I said earlier, that improving the quality of life in Alzheimer's patient is our main focus. So whenever as a physician I get any case, it's our first intention to improve the quality of life. ACHA inhibitors, NMDA receptor uncompatible antagonists, and antipsychotic drugs are effective in BPSD treatment. However, the effects are not completely satisfactory. In particular, antipsychotic drugs can cause adverse effects such as drug-induced extrapyramidal symptoms, or it can cause drowsiness, gait disturbances, and other symptoms can result in a decrease of the patient's quality of life in Alzheimer's disease. In contrast, there was no adverse effect or significant change in the laboratory data in our cases during the turmeric treatment. Based on these results, turmeric treatment in Alzheimer's is safer than other pharmacological treatment and useful for patients, and that there is a possibility reduced in the dose of the antipsychotic drugs which are being used. So when a person who is already on antipsychotic drugs, by just giving turmeric, there is a possibility to reduce the antipsychotic drugs and gradually even wean them off it, which is quite remarkable. So BPSD occurs in about 50 to 90% of Alzheimer's patients, and an imbalance between the different neurotransmitters such as serotonin, dopamine, glutamine, acetylcholine, and norepinephrine are related to the pathophysiology of BPSD in Alzheimer's disease. So curcumin, now we understand that how does curcumin really work in Alzheimer's at a chemical level. So curcumin, a major active component of turmeric, possesses some interesting properties. So curcumin modulates the levels of norepinephrine, dopamine, and serotonin in the brain. And it inhibits the MOAA and the MOAB enzyme. So this enzyme that decomposes dopamine and serotonin. So dopamine is involved in pleasure, emotion, and it basically regulates locomotions. While serotonin has a major role to play in neurovegetative functions of the body, such as appetite, sleep, memory, and learning. It also helps in temperature regulation, in mood behavior, in cardiovascular functions, in muscle contractions, and in endocrine regulation. And now norepinephrine is a neurotransmitter involved in attentiveness, emotion, sleeping, dreaming, and learning. And we speculate that turmeric significantly reduces the behavioral symptoms of Alzheimer's patients by modifying these neurotransmitting dysfunction. So what the author wants to say is that curcumin can actually modify by playing a direct role on the dopamine, the serotonin, and the norepinephrine. And there are references for this, which I'll share later. And mounting reports have suggested preventive and or therapeutic potential of curcumin and other products from turmeric in the pathology of Alzheimer's disease, such as the amyloid beta cascade, a tau phosphorylation, and neuroinflammation or oxidative stress. Several studies have shown that curcumin are powerful antioxidants and possessive strong anti-inflammatory activity. So the entire reasoning behind of the selection of the drug is because turmeric is an antioxidant and anti-inflammatory. And to prove this, the author gives a few examples, saying that in vitro studies have shown that curcumin attenuates the inflammatory response of the brain microglial cells and inhibits the formation of amyloid beta oligomers in fibrils. Amyloid beta oligomers are highly toxic and viewed as playing an important role in the Alzheimer's disease pathology. In vivo studies show that curcumin can reverse the diuretic abnormality resulting from amyloid beta production.
Okay.
I'm sorry, was there a break in my signal? Pranita, ma'am?
Hello? Yeah, sorry. Yeah. Sorry, Abhishek. Please continue.
No. Okay, so was there a break in the signal or was it okay?
There was a break. Yeah.
Okay. I'm sorry about that. I think there was a problem with the Wi-Fi. Yeah, so as I was saying, the in vivo study shows that curcumin can reverse the neuritic abnormalities resulting from the amyloid beta production. In transgenic mice model of Alzheimer's, so curcumin was seen to prevent the neuronal damage in the brain as it directly binds a small amyloid beta species to block aggression and fibril formation. Another study using a transgenic mouse has shown that dietary curcumin significantly lowered oxidized proteins and interleukin-1 beta, a pro-inflammatory cytokine in the neuroinflammatory cascades involved in the neuritic plaque formation in the brain. And this study also proved that with the curcumin treatment, the astrocytic marker, which is glial, which is a GFAP, was reduced. And insoluble and soluble amyloid beta and plaque burden was significantly decreased. For the treatment of Alzheimer's, ACHE inhibitors and NMD receptor competitive antagonists are commonly used. And curcumin possesses pronounced ACHE inhibitory activity in the frontal cortex and hippocampus of Alzheimer's disease in experimental animals, and protects against NMDA-induced toxicity in the in vitro studies. And furthermore, it is seen that curcumin has also reported to increase the cholinesterase transferase, which is the CHAT activity, a synthesizing enzyme for acetylcholine in the hippocampus of Alzheimer's model rat. It has been reported that curcumin can be effective in preventing and suppressing cognitive impairment on the grounds that it possesses antioxidant, anti-neuroinflammatory effects, and it also modulates the cholinergic system. So as we knew earlier that turmeric is anti-inflammatory, but the author gives us references saying that it is not only that, curcumin also is anti-neuroinflammatory. So in any of the inflammatory conditions of the neurological systems, we can use this. So be it Alzheimer's, be it Parkinson's disease, or any extrapyramidal lesions, or any inflammatory conditions, even in, for example, in Guillain-Barré syndrome and multiple sclerosis. Personally, I have also used curcumin in these two conditions post the inflammation as a rasayana, and I found to be very, very effective. I'll come back to it later in the discussion part. So epidemiological studies show that increased consumption of curry, which usually contains turmeric, is associated with better cognitive performance in non-dementiated patients. However, in a clinical trial in China, 34 patients with probable or possible Alzheimer's are randomized to 4 grams, 1 gram, and 0 gram of turmeric once a day, showed no significant changes in the MMSE score or the plasma A-beta 40 levels between 0 to 6 months. So here we have one study in China which proves otherwise. So again, it all depends on which avastha it is given. In our report, one patient improved his MMSE scores. In the other two cases, the cognitive declines were too severe to take MMSE. However, they came to recognize their family. The improvement of the cognitive function might be due to the activation of the CHAT and the ACHE inhibitors, and or because of the stabilization of the patient's mental status by turmeric. So he just wants to conclude by saying that among the three patients, two did not have a good improvement in MMSE score, but there was a symptomatic improvement. And this is because both the patients had an MMSE score of 1 on 30 and 0 on 30. They were in the far end spectrum. And one patient had a good improvement. So at last, he wants to conclude by saying that a turmeric treatment adding to the routine therapy increases the quality of life and activities of daily living of patients and eases the caregiver's burden. So this is the first case report demonstrating that turmeric is an effective and safe drug for the treatment of the behavioral and psychological symptoms of dementia in Alzheimer's patients, and that it may impair a cognitive function. So the references, I'm sure that you have the references with you. So basically what I really liked about this article is that the discussion part, where the authors have gone in detail to find references to show that what might possibly be the mode of action. And so this is something which I really liked about them. So I just want to stop the slide sharing here. And we are joined by a lot of senior doctors. So if anyone has any discussion, we can keep the forum open and y'all can give in your inputs if you are free to any cases of Alzheimer's, and we can have an open discussion here. If you have any queries or questions, y'all can either post it over here in the chat section, or you can come online and give your views.
Hello. Sir, your voice is not audible. Hello.
Yes, am I clear now?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah. So actually, I have just got a personal chat over here where a doctor has asked me that, have you ever used any other single rasayanas in your practice? So I just want to ask a question that, you know, actually, I was very fortunate to be trained under Dr. Srinivas Acharya, sir, who is now the principal of SDM Ayurveda College in Udupi. And we actually used a lot of single herbs in Rasayana. For example, like even in my thesis in back in college, we did one particular study on Lashuna in a Rasayana, which was used in neurological conditions. We used plain Lashuna Rasayana in sciatica. We also used again Lashuna Rasayana in a lot of neuroinflammatory conditions, like as I said, in Guillain-Barré syndrome and in multiple sclerosis. Then we used, for example, Tuvaraka Tela in a Rasayana form in psoriasis patients. We have used then Gugulu as a Rasayana in osteoarthritis. We have used Pipali Rasayana very, very effectively in bronchial asthma. And we have also used Vardhamana Pipali Rasayana in cancer patients. So yeah, I mean, I was quite fortunate, and still even in my practice, I use a lot of this. So especially for my patients who are outside of India, sometimes getting medicines in certain countries becomes a little difficult. And for them, we have to use herbs which are grown locally so that the treatment modality becomes easier. Ideally, before a Rasayana Chikitsa, I would go in for Shodhana, a classical Shodhana where Snehapana, Virechana or Vamana is given as per the condition. And that is when I start a Rasayana. I think we...
Dr. Abhishek, we have one more question.
Yes, ma'am.
If patient is on blood thinners, can we use curcumin? And what caution needs to be taken?
Yes. So this is a very good question over here. So basically, as you know that, you know, even like, for example, Hridra basically is Ushna Virya. It is a Lekhana. So what happens is when you have a Ushna Virya drug like Hridra in Pittaja conditions, people who have Pitta Prakriti, I don't personally give it. Also, people who are on blood thinners, I try to avoid if they have a Pittaja Prakriti, because otherwise it can cause complications. So it's very important to have a list of indication and contraindications. And those on blood thinners, I personally try to avoid.
Yeah, sir, one more question. What is the composition of Yoku Kansal?
Yeah. So this, as I said, you know, basically contains about seven traditional herbs. So it contains about 4 grams of Lacina rhizoma, 4 grams of Puria, 3 grams of Sindhi rhizoma, 3 grams of Angelica radix, 2 grams of blueberry radix, and 1.5 grams of glycyrrhizae, and 3 grams on Yuncaris unis. So this, if you can just go and Google it. So this actually has been approved by the Ministry of Health, Labor and Welfare in Japan, and is used as a prescription, which is covered under the National Health Insurance Plan. It's normally given at a dose of about 2.5 grams, about 3 times a day, or if you use an extract form, about 1 gram of the extract per day.
Thank you, Dr. Abhishek, for a wonderful session. And I must appreciate that the selection of article was so good that you have incorporated 360-degree analysis of curcumin use in various case scenarios. And that definitely added an edge for the new practitioners as well as postgraduate students who want to work in curcumin research. This journal club activity is really taking now, the gears are changing and shifting to the new speed now. So I would like to invite many more participants, and they can write to us if they have any queries regarding this article or they want to discuss something about curcumin with Dr. Abhishek. Thank you so much, Dr. Abhishek, and it was a wonderful session. As usual, it was very encouraging. And I would also like to appreciate Dr. Rani Gupta. Now she has taken a new responsibility as a co-chair for Journal Club Activity, India chapter. And on behalf of Journal Club, I would like to thank all the attendees who were there patiently listening to the whole presentation. they put up their queries also, and I'm looking forward to their participation in future activities as well. Thank you so much, everyone, and keep in touch and keep researching, keep exploring.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you.